He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. Whosoever denieth the Son, the same hath not the Father. But he that acknowledgeth the Son hath the Father also.
If anybody attacks the message and the mission of Jesus Christ, he is Antichrist. Muhammad claimed that God has no son, and Jesus never died. He is Antichrist. The message and the mission of Muhammad was to undo the message and the mission of Christ Jesus. He is Antichrist.
But even if we, or an angel from heaven, should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let them be under God's curse. As we have already said, so now I say again, if anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let them be under God's curse.
Muhammad preached a different gospel that we already have in the Holy Bible. Islam is Antichrist, and under God's curse. God wants them to accept his only Son, Lord Jesus, for salvation. Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. The Bible records how Jesus fulfilled prophecy when he was born to the Virgin Mary. He grew up unique from any other human because he never sinned. Crowds flocked to hear his teaching and marvel at his miracles. Jesus healed the sick, raised the dead, and walked on water. Of all people, Jesus did not deserve to die. Yet, Jesus prophesied that he would be crucified and raised from the dead. His words came to pass. Soldiers beat Jesus and put a crown of thorns on his head. People mocked and spit on him. Nails pierced his hands and feet into a wooden cross. Jesus had the power to save himself, but he gave himself, willingly dying on the cross. 3 days later, Jesus rose from the grave. Why the cross? As a Muslim, you may ask. Why would Allah allow his prophetessa to be mistreated and killed? Jesus' death was essential because every person is a sinner. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Whether dishonoring parents, telling a lie, failing to love God best, or disbelieving God's word. We each have sinned against the holy God. The punishment for sin is death. For the wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23. God pours out his wrath against unbelieving sinners by separating them forever in hell. As the just judge, God will not overlook sin. We cannot save ourselves by good works, and we cannot buy our way into heaven. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. This is a key difference between Christianity and Islam. Islam teaches that a person can earn paradise by keeping the five pillars. Even if possible to outweigh bad deeds with good deeds, the Bible teaches that all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. Even one single sin makes a person guilty of breaking all God's law. Sinful humans can do nothing to merit heaven. God sacrificed his Son for sinners. Jesus said,
"For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life."
God knew mankind's sin kept them from heaven. God knew the only way the sin debt could be paid was by a perfect one paying the price of death. God knew he alone could pay such an infinite price. So God's eternal plan was to send his Son Jesus to die in the believing sinner's place. As a Muslim, you may say, "Oh, I believe in Jesus. I believe Isa was a true teacher, a great prophet, and a good man." But you cannot say Jesus was a true teacher and yet deny his teaching that he is the only way, truth, and life. You cannot believe Jesus was a great prophet and yet reject his prophecy that he would die and rise again in 3 days. You cannot admit Jesus is a good man, yet disbelieve his claim to be the Son of God.
Hello, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to another show of this wonderful series that we've been doing with Dr. Jay Smith. Many of you know who he is. He's been at the Speaker's Corner for almost 25 years. He is a debater. He's an Islamic apologist and a polemist. And he represents also a amazing center called the Founder Center for Apologetics. And also he represents another interesting and amazing also ministry called I Square, among many other things, of course. And we congratulate you, by the way, on your PhD. And we're excited that Dr. Jay Smith has been with us here in studio for a few days now. And we've been doing a lot of these, series on the topics that are extremely problematic, extremely provocative, topics that I think a lot of people need to know about, but not just any people. Our Muslim friends need to be fully aware of them. And as a former Muslim myself, who grew up, born, raised in Saudi, and used to think one way about Islam and its history and its book and its man, I find it fascinating, of course, now that we are discussing new discoveries that contradicts a lot, if not all, of the traditional views within the Islamic scholarship. And that's what we're doing, myself and Dr. Jay Smith. Today, we are going to take another look and take a different angle in relationship to those traditional views. And we will start by talking about the traditional dating as it relates to the start of Islam, the rise of Islam, the history of the Prophet of Islam. And from there, we'll venture into a whole lot of interesting topics, I'm sure. Dr. Smith, thank you so much for joining me here.
Well, it's good to be here, and Al, exactly what you have been saying. Remember the earlier episodes, we said that Islam really is dependent on two pillars, you might say, that hold it up. And those pillars are one book modeled by one man. The Book of the Man.
Correct.
The Book of the Man. We've said this many times. We've been bringing it up in our own discussions. It all comes back to one book modeled by one man. And now the former, earlier episodes, I think we did about 9 of them, they were all zeroed in on the book, the Quran itself. Now we're moving to the man himself. We're now going into the next pillar. And we're looking from a historical standpoint, what does history tell us? And this is why it will be damaging. And we're warning Muslims right up front, this is not going to be easy to listen to. We do not apologize for this. This has already been done against our book and our man. For 150 years, we've had these same questions, redacted criticism, source criticism, historical criticism, literary criticism. All these criticisms were created confronting the Bible and the person of Jesus Christ.
Correct.
And we've answered every one of those criticisms. That's why we understand this material better than probably anybody else, because we've had to work through it, especially the last 100 years, we've had to work through it. Now we're taking that edifice, all those criticisms, and bringing them over to Islam and asking the same questions that have been asked of our Bible, we asked of the Quran. We did that in the previous episodes. The same questions that were asked of Jesus Christ and how Christianity began, we are now moving to the person of Muhammad and Islam and Mecca and these areas. How did Islam really begin? And these are the questions we're going to do in these episodes. Now, to do that, we need to look and see what they say. And the Muslims are very clear that they have what they call the classical account.
That's correct.
Let's look at the screen, and you can see the dates that are there. So let's start with these dates. This is what you hear in every school, I don't know of any other college or university in the world that has any other story but this story that we're going to show here. That the story is, the narrative is, Muhammad was born in 570.
Correct.
Okay? No one's ever doubted that. That he was born in a place called Mecca. No one's ever doubted that. That in 610, he was in a cave, and the angel Jibril, as we know Gabriel in the Bible, came down and, as we said in the previous episode, said, Akra, read. And his response was, Ma'akra, I cannot read. Squeezed
right.
3 times, and he goes back to Khadija, his wife, and she does a little test, have him sit on either knee, then disrobe and ask him, was this really an angel? And that proved that this was something authentic. And then she goes and has him talk to her cousin, Waraka ibn Nawfal. who is a Nestorian Christian. One of the ironies is a Nestorian Christian gives him and says, truly, you are a prophet. So it's a Nestorian Christian, according to the Islamic traditions, this narrative that really give Muhammad his authority. That was all in 610. So from 610 to roughly 622, there you can see on the slide, he then receives these Meccan revelations. And by that we mean the second half of the Quran.
That's right, and it's very distinguishable, of course, in style and format and everything
else. And how is it distinguishable?
I mean, it's known to be short, poetic rhymes. A lot of young Muslim kids, you know, usually start there and by memorizing.
And most of the Meccan material we can accept. There's not too much that we would have a problem
with. That's right.
God is up here, man is down here.
Correct.
God does not enter time and space. There's nothing between God and man. So he needs these intermediaries called these rasuls, these nabis, and many of the stories there are about biblical characters. They're not the same stories you and I have, and that's they do not equate with the Bible as we talked yesterday.
That's correct.
But that Meccan material is the easy material. That's the acceptable material.
Correct.
Then he moves in 620 to, well, before that, in 621, as you can see in the narrative, he is woken up in the middle of the night, told to get on the back of a winged horse called the Burak, and he flies from Mecca up to Medina and then goes up to the seven heavens.
To Jerusalem, you mean?
Miraj, yeah. Sorry, did I say, I'm sorry, Jerusalem.
Yeah.
And that's where the Dome of the Rock supposedly is situated, where that happens, where he then goes up. We're going to come back to the Dome of the Rock, hugely significant later on in these episodes. But that's where, called the Miraj. How do you pronounce
it? Yes, Mi'raj.
Mi'raj. So I'll let you do the pronunciation so I don't desecrate it and make a fool of myself. That happens in 621. And then the next year, he then goes from Mecca up to Medina, and that's called the Hijrah. That's the exodus from Mecca to Medina. And that's the beginning of the Medinan revelations, the first half of the Quran. Rule of thumb, first half, because there is some Meccan material in the Medinan chapters. There is some Medina material in the Meccan chapter. But rule of thumb, those really, if you take the Quran and just split it in half, here's the Quran right here, and you just put your thumb, this part, which is the first half, would be Medina, this part would be Meccan. It goes backwards. So just turn the Quran upside down and you get the right sequence.
Yeah, and now, technically speaking, it's not organized really in such a manner, just to clarify for our audience.
So how is it organized?
It's organized by chapter size mainly.
Largest to smallest.
Exactly.
It's just that he was not very long-winded at the very beginning of his ministry. He became very long-winded at the end of his ministry.
Right.
I'm saying that tongue-in-cheek. Please don't take that literally. That's the sequence that we're assuming that this narrative is correct.
Correct.
We're going to destroy everything I've just said in a few hours, but let's continue on with that classical narrative. So if you look at the screen there, from 622 to 632, the last 10 years of his life, then the Medinan revelations are given. In 630, he then comes back down to
Mecca,
and takes over without firing a shot. No war. He did it peacefully. And then in 632, suddenly he dies, which tends to happen with most of us. You can't choose when you're going to die. Some believe maybe he was poisoned. We don't know. But that's what the traditions say. Abu Bakr takes over for the next 2 years. He dies peacefully. Umar then takes over from him, and he goes from 634 to 644. The next tenure, he is killed. Uthman then takes over from 644 to 656. He is killed.
That's
and
right.
As we said in their previous episodes, that's when the Quran was finally written down. And then Ali, the adopted son of Muhammad, should have been the rightful heir according to the Shiites. He then rules for 5 years in 656 to 661, and then he is killed.
That's right.
That is the narrative. That's the only story I've ever heard. Is that the only story you grew up with?
That's the story you've heard. And of course, when you get into the Shia version of events, they will tell you Ali would have been the righteous caliph to start with because he's the cousin of Muhammad. He's almost like the brother of Muhammad. He's the father of Muhammad's only surviving, at least at that time, grandchildren and so on and so forth. But this is the traditional Sunni.
Now, explain what you've just said. Muhammad had no heirs, did he?
He did not.
He had four daughters.
And
he did have two sons.
And they supposedly died mysteriously.
They died when they were too young.
Very young.
They were still children. So he had no male heirs. What is one of the odd things? If he had 12 wives, why is it he could not produce two sons? I leave that for the Muslims to answer. But that's a question I've asked many Muslims. You know, he's not much of a model as far as if you want to ask for his fidelity. Not fidelity, but certainly that's another question. But certainly he was able to produce two sons. That's ironic in and of itself. But what we do know is Ali was the one that, according to the Shiites, should have been the rightful heir.
Correct.
Because he was part of the family.
Correct.
Now, do you know any other story? Now, I'm not giving you everything. This is just the skeleton. Do you know any other story besides this?
I mean, this is pretty much what every Muslim needs to know about. Of course, you learn later that there was a biography about Muhammad, Sirat Rasulullah.
Okay, now before you get into that, let's just look at this graph again. Yeah. This everything you see in red, in that dotted red line, is what we're talking about. Those are the dates.
With
the birth of Muhammad, 570, and the death, 632. That's in that rectangular red dotted line.
Correct.
Now, let me ask you, we're talking about the 7th century. Certainly, that story, that narrative of Muhammad's life, what he did, how it happened, how Islam really began, how the Quran was finally tabulated, all that should have been written down by someone who was there, right?
That's right. At least you would expect someone who was fascinated by the whole thing would have wrote it down.
And there was no reason why they didn't know how to read and write at that time, correct?
We know of people like Ibn Mas'ud and Ubay who wrote down even Revelations.
Okay, it mentioned that they wrote it down. Now, was this story, that everything I've just told you, was it written in that red dotted area?
No, it was written later.
Oh, so let's look and see. Let's go up the slide again. This is not when it was written in the red area. It was written here. It was first written down by, the story of Muhammad's life was first written down by a man named Ibn Hisham. Hold on a minute. Okay, be careful. Ibn Ishaq is what is attributed. That's what Muslims
That's right.
claim.
Correct.
See, his name is there. Look, and you can see. We put it up there. Look at the date, 765, Ibn Ishaq. You notice I didn't put the red line around his name. Why haven't I done that?
Because his material, at least most of it, is lost.
Look, none of it exists. We don't have any documents today from Ibn Ishaq. The first documents we have are from Ibn Hisham. Look at the date, 833. Ibn Hisham takes what was given to him by his own teacher, who was a student of Ibn Ishaq.
That's right.
And throws out what he doesn't like and only retains what he does like and then writes it down in the – and so that is the first tabulated biography that is extant today.
And the interesting thing is he introduces also for the first time the genealogy of Muhammad in there.
Interestingly, and this is in 833.
That's correct.
Now, let's do your math. 632 is when Muhammad died. 833 is when Ibn Hisham died. How many years have we got
201 years.
200 years. It takes them 200 years to write down the first biography of Muhammad.
And one of the most basic requirements for a biography is eyewitness accounts.
Absolutely. Now, even more than that, most Muslims don't go to the Sira. That's the biography. They go to the Hadith. So when was the first compilation extant that exists today of the Hadith of Muhammad?
240 years.
There it is right there on the graph. Let's look at the graph again. There it is. 870 is when al-Bukhari dies. He's the first to tabulate it in one form. He was given 600,000 of these akhbars, and he whittles them down, throws out all of them except for about 7,400, basically 397. That's 98% he throws out and only retains 2%. Throws out the vast majority, retains only 2%, and that's the 9 volumes that we have today.
Correct.
We're thinking that's the 9. It's attributed to him because even the earliest document we have for al-Bukhari is not to the 11th century, and that's only one volume. You have to go to the 17th century to get all 9 together.
That's correct.
This is there's an awful lot yet to do research on al-Bukhari and whether or not he's even authority.
Exactly, because the fundamental question is, do we have even an original manuscript for al-Bukhari?
No, we don't. Not until the 11th century, and he was there in the 9th century. So it takes another 200 years before we even get a manuscript that we can even attribute to him, and that's only one volume of 9. So there you're talking about 240 years after the Prophet. When you get to the tafsir and the tahriq, which would be the commentaries that explain the Quran, and the tahriq, which would be the history of all of mankind up until the time of Muhammad, they are introduced by a man named al-Tabari. Look on the graph again. You'll see when he died, 923. So that's the 10th century. So everything we know about Muhammad, everything, you can see it on this graph there, everything we know about who Muhammad was, what he did, comes from Ibn Ishaq, 765. We don't have his material. So we have to go to Ibn Hisham, 833, al-Bukhari, 870, al-Tabari, 923, and later.
And I want to just make a comment right here. I'm going to ask my Muslim friends who are watching this, doesn't this prove to you that Islam is a man-made all the way? All the way.
Hundreds of years later.
Exactly. I mean, what else, what kind of evidence do you need to prove that it's 200 years later, you have information all of a sudden written about a man that lived 200 years earlier? Would you yourself write anything about somebody who lived 100 years earlier or 50 years earlier without a single eyewitness account and be able to publish it?
No, we're Christians. We go to Jesus Christ. Let's go up and look at the slide I want to put up next, because look at this slide. Here's a comparison. If we as Christians were dependent on who Jesus Christ was, what he did and what he said, and we know that immediately from the writings of Paul were written within 15 years of Christ's death. We know that the tafsir, let's do like with like. The sirah of Jesus, which would be the biography of Jesus, would be Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Right? That's correct. That would be his life.
The equivalent to that.
That's the black letter of the Gospels.
That's correct.
The hadith, what Jesus said, would be the red letters. In my Bible, we have red and black. What Jesus said is written in red. That would be the hadith of Jesus.
Correct.
So we know that three of those, the sirah and the hadith of Jesus, were written within at the latest 40 years after Christ's death for Matthew, Mark, and Luke. John would have been written within 60 years of Christ's death. And when you talk about equivalence, if you want to look at tafsir, that would be Paul's letters, would be the tafsir. They were written within 15 years of Christ's death. It begun to.
That's right.
If you want to talk about the history, that would be the book of Acts.
That's correct.
It would be the history of the early church.
And written probably within
between
also
52 and 62 AD, right, by Luke. So there you have the sirah, the hadith, the tafsir, and the tahrih of Jesus, all written within 15 to 60 years of Christ's death. Look at the exact same genre for Islam about who Muhammad was, what he said, and about the history of early Islam. That is 200 to 300 years difference. If we were dependent on who Jesus was, and we had the very same type of material that Islam has about Muhammad and the beginning of Islam, we would know nothing about Jesus until the 3rd century.
Correct.
Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John would not have existed in the 1st century. We would be dependent on the 3rd century to even know who this man was, what he did. How would we defend him?
And you know, brother, here is what troubles me, is that Muslims keep always going back to the fact that the one of the early, the P52 papyri, that it dates like 100 or to 110 AD. They're upset about that, and how can we even prove that any of the accounts are true? Yet it is still within the range versus the 300.
Basically, what we're saying is Islam has a real problem here. Everything we know about who Muhammad was, how Islam began, what happened between him and his wives and his family, where even the name Mecca is nothing that exists in the first century. And we're going to get even better as we move into these episodes. We're going to now move into what the concern is of the historians. You can see already, we're now doing like with like. And like with like, I'm so glad that we as Christians have authoritative eyewitness account. Matthew and John were actually there. They were with Jesus for the last 3 years. They saw what he did. They heard what he said. They wrote verbatim what they knew about what he said and did. Thank God for the eyewitness accounts. Mark and Luke got it from the eyewitnesses. And that's why we can know exactly who Jesus was, what he said. If you want to talk about whether we have the originals or not, that's not even in question. Nobody doubts that Jesus existed. Nobody doubts that he died on the cross. We have Thallus, we have Phlegon, we have Tacitus, we have Josephus,
even
Greek,
non-Christian
Roman
sources.
All of these non-Christians that support the death of Jesus Christ. We talked about that in an early episode. When you look at what we have historically versus what Islam has historically, there's no comparison, but it gets much worse. We're going to show you now what we're now finding, because everything we know is from the 9th and 10th century. That's 200 to 300 years later. Wouldn't you like to go back to the 7th century?
Absolutely.
We're going to do that in the next episode. Thanks so much for having me on board, and thanks so much for giving me both of us a platform now to actually ask the historical question. And that's what we want to do. We want to see not what the narratives say from each viewpoint. We want to know what history is actually telling us. Right. And the historians are very suspicious that everything they know about Muhammad and, of course, Islam is 200 to 300 years after the fact. Now, let's put up the screen and let's look and see what their concern is. And this is from these are Western historians who are Islamicists. They are all experts in Islam. This is their concern. Dr. Humphrey says, Islam as we know it did not exist in the 7th century, but evolved over a period of 200 to 300 years. He said this way back in 1991, so this is older material. This is not new. What we're introducing right now is not the newest material. So Muslims should not be shocked by what we're going to be saying in the episodes yet to come. Dr. Andrew Rippon, who has just died actually last year, he said this: the Quran probably was not revealed to one man in 22 years, but likely evolved over a period of 50 to 100 years. We do know that Wandsbur also supports this. He said this in 1977. Rippon said this in 1985. Toby Lester, who wrote that famous article, was referring to this in 1999. The conclusion is that the history of Islam, at least from the time of the Caliph Abdul Malik, hold that name in your, under your cap. This is an important name. Abdul Malik, who ruled from 685 to 705 and before, is a later fabrication. Dr. Patricia Crook, Crone, Dr. Michael Cook, Robinson, these are all the ones who are making and coming to the, how do they come to this conclusion? And that's what we want to do today. We want to know and see how they came to the conclusion. Well, let's take a look at the next slide. If so much of the Islamist history, and this is their concern, was created so late, like we said in the first episode, why did it take so long to write it all down? Why did it take 200 to 300 years to write this down? If this is the greatest prophet in the history of mankind, if this is the seal of all the prophets, they should have written down right away.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And Muslims, whenever I've asked this, they said, well, they were not literate. Now, hold on. Stop a minute. They controlled Basra, Baghdad, Damascus, Jerusalem, Cairo by 652. All those five great cities of the Levant were under their jurisdiction. By the time Abdul Malik comes to power in 685, they controlled all the way from Spain in the west to India in the east. That whole land, swath of land, was under their control. Nobody could read and write between India and Spain?
They had a lot of educated people in there.
Absolutely. And remember, there was a library in Alexandria that was destroyed in the 5th century. This is 200 years before what we're talking about. What do you have in libraries if they're not books? So certainly they could read and write. They were not illiterate. This was, weren't we just talking about the compilation of the Quran at the time of Abu Bakr, the first compilation by Abu Bakr? Zayd ibn Thabit does that in 632 to 634. Didn't we also talk about a second compilation by Uthman?
Absolutely.
This is the mid-7th century. Even the tradition tells us that the Quran was written down. So certainly someone had to know how to read and write if they wrote it
down. Absolutely. And they, Muhammad himself, according to the tradition, had people around him in his immediate circle, close circle, that used to write for him.
Absolutely. Ubay ibn Ka'b, Ibn Masud, Ibn Musa, Zayd ibn Thabit. Who are these guys? Right. They were all writing codices. So this idea of illiteracy maybe worked for Muhammad and just for him, but certainly not for his companions and certainly not for the Quran. Now, so where did the 9th century, where did al-Bukhari, where did Sahih Muslim, where did Ibn Daud, where did Tirmidhi, where did they get their material from?
Correct.
If they didn't know the man, if they weren't there, hadn't seen him, 200 or 300 years, if they didn't know that, then our question, and this is a good question, historical question, can we therefore trust it? If it's 200 to 300 years later.
Yep.
And should we therefore go back to the 7th century? Shouldn't we go back to what actually happened? So let's do that. And let's see what they're finding.
Let's do it.
Now this gets fun. Because it's when we go back to that century that we're going to see loft. Now let's just look at this map here. I'll put it up on the slide there. You can see it. Look at the brown area. That's the area that they controlled by 661. So we're talking roughly 30 years after Muhammad's death. All that brown area, that includes Persia and Arabia. They're starting to move across Libya, over across northern Africa, and they're going to eventually get all the way up to Andalusia. And over the other direction to the east, they're going to eventually get all the way to the Mongol Empire in India. So that's the swath of land that they control within 30 to 40 to 60 years, because we're looking at the first 60 years after Muhammad's death, up to the time of Abdul Malik, who is the great caliph, the great reformer. He's going to be coming into quite a bit, and that's why I keep on remembering mentioning his name as we move into this material. But just so you get the map, so you see what we're looking at. Now, let's look at this slide, because these are the major scholars I'll be using and I have been using. Dr. John Wandsbur, he was head of department at School of Oriental African Studies there in the University of London in London. He wrote two books called Quranic Studies and Sectarian Milieu in 1977 and 1978. That blew open this whole thing of historical criticism because he was basically saying in those two books, everything we see in the Quran does not make sense for the 7th century. This is material that was what they wouldn't have had access to until the 8th century, because these were being written in places like Ctesiphon, which was the archaic name for Baghdad. It doesn't make sense this early. From a literary standpoint, I don't understand how you can have this kind of material that early, because it's all been borrowed. He was very clear. It has been borrowed. We know who they borrowed from because this material that they borrowed from, like we said in our earlier episodes, were written down in the 2nd century, in the 5th century, but they were not in the Hijaz, in that part of the world that Correct. Muhammad was living, if he did live down there. Haunting, who is my professor when I was at School of Oriental African Studies in 19, I was there in 1994. 1995, and I studied under him. He has been the one that just opened up for me. I had never heard this material until I studied under him about all the problems of the first century of Islam. Dr. Patricia Corona, this woman from Denmark who studied under Dr. Wandsbøl and got her doctorate there at SOAS, then went and was head of department at Oxford University when she wrote Meccan Trade in the Rise of Islam. We're going to talk about her when we get to Mecca. She reads and writes 15 languages.
I know, in different languages, absolutely.
And these are archaic languages. These are not modern languages. These are archaic languages. I don't know anyone that has that kind of caliber. She's a linguist. So she went back, and she did what all historians should do. She went back to the original documents. That's why she is so threatening to a lot of Muslims. They absolutely hate her guts. Now, she has just died last year.
That's right.
But I got to know her when she then wrote this book. She was then got death threats and then moved to Cambridge University. And she helped me put my – in fact, she was the one that helped me put my debate together in 1995 when I debated Dr. Jamal Badawi on this material. That was in 1995, August of 1995. I did my first debate with Dr. Jamal Badawi, considered to be the world authority on the Quran in the English-speaking world at that time. He came through the Trinity School at Cambridge, and we did this debate, a two-hour debate, and I gave him 10 historical challenges. 1995, we're talking about. We're now in 2018.
And they remain probably standing.
Those 10 questions he could not answer. They are still up there on the internet today, and we're going to unpack some of them. But we've moved way beyond since 1995. It's much easier today, as you're going to find out as we go through this episode. Dr. Rippon from Oxford University at that time, he's now moved. He's no longer there. But when I knew him, he was at Oxford University. He reads and writes 18 languages. So these are linguists. These are the ones. That's why they're so dangerous, because they're going back to the original documents. That was Hoyland. It was from Oxford. Dr. Andrew Rippon is from Calgary, and he was the one that probably has taken this very difficult academic material and brought it to layman's terminology.
That's correct.
Why and I recommend him.
Focus on the Quran a lot.
There you go. And he focuses on Islam and how Islam began, and he's got some great material on their beliefs and practices.
Correct.
Now, Hoyland is the one I meant to talk about. Is from Oxford. He reads and writes 18 languages.
And he has a wonderful book, by the way, Seeing Islam as Others
See It. And probably the best book that actually shows that the people that were living at that time did not know about this religion.
They were just quotations, but not specific names or anything like that.
There was no reference to a people called Muslims, no reference to a religion called Islam, no reference to a book called the Quran, and no reference to a man named Muhammad, except from external sources. We'll get to that later. Dr. Yehuda Nevo, out of University of Jerusalem, did the best work in looking on the earliest inscriptions, showing us that the documentary book just doesn't fit this historical narrative coming out of Islam. And then from the German school, you have Dr. Gunther Luning, you have Dr. Gerd Puin, you have Dr. von Bothmer, and you have Dr. Oleg. These are the ones that we used a bit in our last episodes, who then unpacked the Quran and looked at the earliest manuscripts.
Could you give our audience just the 1 minute maybe explanation? What do we mean by the revisionist?
Okay. Revising is what it means. A revisionist is someone who looks at a narrative and says, well, there are some problems here. And they said, we need to see what history is telling us. We need to revise it back to the historical record.
In other words, in this case, revising some of the traditional Islamic dates.
Huge revisionism. And that's why revisionist is a dirty word for Muslims. Muslims hate the name revisionist. The another name they give is Orientalists. They are part – the Orient is now today, you would think of China. Back in the 1800s and 1900s, the Orient always meant the Middle East. So Orientalism is a study of – really a study of Islam. Unfortunately, it doesn't make sense in the 21st century because Orient, but that's the traditional name for the academic name for someone who is an expert on the Middle East, the
Correct.
Orientalist.
Correct.
And they hate the name Orientalist because that's a Western scholar who is studying Islam. So these are all Orientalists.
That's correct.
And these are all, these names that we have up on that slide there are all from the revisionist school.
Thank you.
Now, there are three books that have been popularized, and this is probably, rather than going to their material, I mean, Dr. Patricia Corona, she doesn't translate anything. She keeps it in its original tongue. You and I don't know these languages, so you need someone to unpack that for you.
Correct.
And the person who does that is this man here, Dr. Tom Holland. He is not an Orientalist. He is not a historian. He is a literary critic. In fact, his area of expertise is literature. He's a great writer. He actually explains it. He took 6 years to write that book there, the UK version, the US version, In the Shadow of the Sword. Taking all this material that we're going to introduce, not all of it, but back in 2012, he was able to take it down and put it into one book. If you're going to get a book, read that book first, because that will set the stage of what we're going to be saying. Then he did a documentary called Islam, the Untold Story. Now, this documentary was shown on Channel 4 television in Britain on August 4th. August 28th in 2012. They only showed it one time. It's only 90 minutes long. I have it on my computer here. You can't see, I've been told that some people have been able to find it outside of the UK, but they do not want it to be broadcast outside the UK. When they wanted to broadcast it a second time in November of that same year, there was such an outcry from the Muslim community that they didn't show it a second time. Hmm. You need to watch this document. It's only 90 minutes long. And it takes what he says in his books and puts it in a visual format. But he's very careful not to come to conclusions. He just said, isn't this interesting? Isn't this interesting? He has a Muslim scholar with him from, I think, from Georgetown University, who just said, yes, that is interesting, but I don't care. It's not important because we have 1.8 billion Muslims that they disagree. It's basically his only recourse.
The traditional argument that numbers matter.
We got more people, deal with it. So it's a fascinating documentary. It would be great if you could see it, those of you who are watching it. But I want to go down to this man here, Dan Gibson. Dan Gibson, I've never met him, but I've emailed him, and he did what every researcher should do. He went and he lived in situ. He lived where he did his research. He lived to where the questions were. He lived in Jordan. He lived in Yemen. He lived amongst the Bedouin, and from 1979 to 1979 to 2004, for 25 years, he went and looked at what the Quran was saying. And then he tried to find the places that are in the Quran, the geographical places.
And that makes sense. I mean, if the Quran is talking about something, let's go and verify it.
And then he went and he looked at the mosques. If you look at the slide again, that book there, those are the three things he has written. The Quranic Geography, which came out in 2011. The Sacred City is a documentary which you can get online.
Absolutely.
That came out in 2016. And then just last year, in 2017, he came out with Early Islamic Qiblas.
And I have all of those, and you have probably all of them, and wonderful resources for people to go.
Please get them. If you don't have them, you need to do them. But what we're going to do is we're going to actually end with this one slide. I want you to look at this slide here, because I'm going to tell you what they all said before we even start to prove it.
And I want my audience, especially the Muslims, to pay close attention to this.
This is what they found. Now, we're going to have to prove all this, but let's start with what they found. Number one, the first Arab inscription referencing Muhammad is not till 691. Ooh, 2222.
In other words, there's nothing so far to prove that that name was mentioned prior to this.
From Arab sources. And I'm using the word Arab cautiously.
That's
for
important.
Reason.
Yeah.
Why? Because we don't have any reference to Muslims until the 690s. The word Muslims. So what did these people, these Arabs, call themselves? Well, they call themselves Saracen, which is the name for the Arabs of that area.
That's right.
They call themselves Hagarines because they were
from
in the line of Hagar. They call themselves Ishmaelites because the line of Ishmael through Hagar. They call themselves Maghreb because they're from the Maghreb, which is the area they lived in. And they use the word Muhajirun, which means people of the Exodus. People who are moving, like nomadic people.
Exactly.
Those are the names they gave themselves. Hold on a minute. This is going up to 690. Muhammad died in 632. So for 60 years, they never use the name they should have. They use these other names for themselves.
That's correct.
Where is this reference to Muslim?
It's only common sense.
You would have thought that these are the first Muslims. Why didn't they use it in any documentation we can find today? Let's look at the third category. The first reference to the name Islam is not till 691 introduced on the Dome of the Rock. That's why the Dome of the Rock is so important. We're going to come back to it again because other things were introduced there, as we're going to find later on. Now, and here is the hardest one for Muslims to stomach. The first reference to Mecca is not till 741.
Ooh, and that's on any ancient maps.
Anywhere. This is not even on a map. This is on a document called Apocalypse of Pseudo-Methodius. We're going to talk about it later on when we get to Mecca. But the first reference to Mecca is not till the 8th century. Now, you'll see why that's hugely significant. And then, of course, the first biography, as we talked about earlier, of Muhammad is not introduced until 833. Take a look at those six references and see why this is so damaging to Islam.
Absolutely. And I can't find a better place to stop this exciting, basically, new discoveries that at least you, what I appreciate about you is you share what's out there. This isn't your opinion. This isn't not even your research.
No.
You are recording and reporting to people, just the people, the man on the street. Go, take a look at this source, see what's going on in there, and ask yourself these vital questions. Remember, we have 1.6 billion Muslims who are basing their faith on traditional dates.
Absolutely.
Yep. And we want them to question that.